This is WDSU News at 5.
New information on the case involving 15-year-old Marshall Coulter, the teen who was shot in the head last year by a Marini homeowner and rearrested last week for simple burglary.
This is video of Coulter given to us by a homeowner. That person says Coulter was casing his Marini property. The video was captured just prior to Coulter's arrest last Friday. It comes as legal analysts say the case against Merritt Landry, the man who shot Coulter last year, could now be in jeopardy.
WDSU News reporter Travers Meckel live for us at 5 with what the homeowner who gave us the video is saying, Travers.
Well, Camille, he says he was shocked to learn that the 15-year-old was out of the hospital and even more alarmed to see him on his front porch. Now, this is video taken by surveillance cameras in the Marini on Burgundy Street. The cameras are on Ken Karen's home. Marshall Coulter was arrested the same day and charged with simple burglary for being inside a home right around the corner on Royal Street. The teen was shot in the head last summer by Marini homeowner Merritt Landry. Landry says he acted after Coulter hopped his fence at 2 a.m. and was in his backyard. Landry was arrested for attempted murder, but has not been formally charged. The homeowner who gave us this video says he was shocked to learn that the same teen on his porch was involved in last year's high-profile shooting.
When I looked at the video, I had heard by that point, I didn't get to the video until about 10, 11 o'clock that night, but I had heard at that point, you know, watching the news that he was arrested two blocks over. So I started to look at the video, and they had a picture of him on the news, and I said, that's exactly the same guy. I mean, he had the same shirt on, same pants, same baseball cap, and it was him.
Landry remains free on bond. The NOPD is not giving out many details on Coulter due to the fact that he is 15 and a juvenile. Camille.
All right, Travers, with that update, and yesterday we reported that Coulter had been arrested in 2012, 1 year prior to the Landry incident. He was charged with aggravated battery in that incident.
And now breaking news from Central City. An arrest has been made in connection with last night's shooting of two teens, but the search continues for the gunman, a 52-year-old man who police say shot the two brothers last night, leaving one of them dead. And now family and friends are getting ready to gather to remember Mike McQuell Jackson and his injured brother. Latanya Norton is outside 6th District headquarters now and has more on this. Latanya.
That's right, Scott. 49-year-old Randy Pittman has been arrested in connection with last night's shooting in Central City that happened around 7:30. It's a shooting that claimed the life of 14-year-old Mikhail Jackson. Police say that Randy Pittman was the driver of the getaway car. Meantime, this afternoon, the search continues for Jackson's alleged shooter, 52-year-old Gregory Johnson.
The guy that was shot in the leg was trying to keep his friend who was shot in the head alive and keep him with him.
They were brothers living in Central City, 14-year-old Mikhail and 15-year-old LaMichael Jackson. Their father says the two were walking down the street with a third teen near the intersection of Josephine and Brainerd when several shots were fired.
It kind of sounded like firecrackers, like several pops.
Monday night around 7:30. The younger shot in the head, the older in the leg, who begged his little brother to stay alive.
He was saying, stay with me, man, don't leave. And he was pumping on his chest at first. But the young man was, he wasn't moving and obviously bleeding.
And people were checking for his pulse and trying to stabilize him on the street.
Police say 52-year-old Gregory Johnson is a suspect in the case and allegedly ran after the teenagers moments before the shooting. Johnson's last known address is in the 2000 block of Barone Street. A black bicycle was examined for evidence.
But they said that there was a pool of blood right by the bike.
Meantime, a family struggles to come to grips with the loss of a 14-year-old boy who loved basketball and all sports, who will no longer have his chance to play.
It's just a very sad, sad situation to see somebody suffering like that. And for what?
And once again, 49-year-old Randy Pittman has been arrested and charged with accessory. One count of accessory to first-degree murder, two counts of accessory to attempted murder. And we're told that the father, the 14-year-old's father, Kevin, tells us that his son was a good student. He was a student at Batiste Cultural Arts Center, that his son loved life. And understandably, the father was too upset to go on camera with us today. And at 7 o'clock tonight, there will be a candlelight vigil to honor the young boy. On your side, live in Central City, Latanya Norton, WDSU News.
Again, that candlelight vigil begins at 7 o'clock. Funeral arrangements are being made at this hour. Also in Central City today, a massive police presence in one neighborhood had both the gang unit from the NOPD in response to it. Reporter Gina Swanson is in Central City with more on what happened there today.
Police still on the scene here at Jackson and LaSalle. They have been for several hours. Neighbors first started to alert us of police activity just about 1:15. We did contact authorities. They do tell us there may be a beefed up police presence in Central City, but they also say that this is in no way related to the shootings that occurred yesterday that left one dead and another boy injured. They did say that this is just all part of routine police work. We did see at least one person taken into custody as police are processing the scene. Again, they've been out here for several hours, so neighbors should be advised that a lot of police activity in the area. That's it for now. We're on your side in Central City. I'm Gina Swanson. Back to you.
And right now, Washington Parish officials are still searching for an escaped prison inmate from the Rayburn Correctional Center.
Patrick Martin escaped from the prison around 3 p.m. Sunday. He was working as a trustee in the horse barn and walked off the site. Martin is 6 feet tall and was in prison for aggravated assault and robbery. Anyone with information on his whereabouts is asked to call the Washington Parish Sheriff's Office at 985-732-7160. New at 5 from Baton Rouge tonight, we're expecting to learn how the Louisiana Senate voted on the bill that deals with the jurisdiction of family court in Washington and St. Tammany parishes. At last check before this newscast, the Senate had not yet voted on the bill, but it is being discussed. A recent ruling by the First Circuit Court of Appeals says the family court does not have jurisdiction in certain property matters. The bill, authored by State Representative Kevin Pearson, would clarify the court's jurisdiction and make the family court's authority retroactive. Opponents say such a move would be unconstitutional. Also new at 5 from Baton Rouge, your state lawmaker may be able to carry and use a gun without many of the same restrictions imposed on their constituents if a new bill is passed. Today, the House Criminal Justice Committee voted 10-2 in favor of it. Under the measure, lawmakers could carry a gun in the same places law enforcement can carry. Some lawmakers argue they need to be able to defend themselves since they are often threatened. The group, Gun Rights Across America, opposes the proposal, saying legislators should not get more favorable treatment than their constituents. The proposal now moves to the full House.
Happening tonight, another development under the Path to Progress program will be discussed with neighbors in New Orleans East. This is a look at the area that will be impacted during the upcoming repairs to North Galvez Street and Dalman Road. The $2.7 million project will begin next month and will include resurfacing and installing wheelchair ramps. Tonight's meeting starts at 6 o'clock at the New Life Church of Christ Holiness USA at 5918 Babylon Street. The Paths to Progress is a program to repair, restore more than 60 roadways in Orleans and Jefferson parishes. It's a day set aside for the entire community to help local nonprofits. The Greater New Orleans Foundation is hosting Give NOLA Day, which is the first community-wide 24-hour online event of giving. Just head over to our website, WDSU.com, to support the 300 participating nonprofits. There you'll find a link to Give NOLA, where you can choose an organization. The goal is to have a total of 5,000 people participate to help raise $1 million for local nonprofits. Being a foster child can be a tough life for a kid, and the chance for a carefree childhood sometimes gets lost.
We'll take you to a unique summer camp that's bringing back some much-needed smiles.
And it's a beautiful day today, ditto tomorrow, and then our rain chances begin to go up when we'll have some thunderstorms in Mike's Outcast.
And now let's go over to WDSU anchor Norman Robinson. Norman, you have what we're working on at 6 o'clock?
I do, as usual. Hi, Camille. Hi, Scott. A blighted housing complex in Algiers is attracting criminal activity. Coming up at 6, we'll show you what the problem is and hear from a nonprofit trying to turn the area around. Their plans to revamp 15 acres and a donation to the New Orleans Police Department that will help officers better identify suspects. We'll show you how that works. All coming up new tonight at 6.
On your side in Southeast Louisiana, this is WDSU News at 5 with Scott Walker, Camille Whitworth, and Chief Meteorologist Margaret Orr.
We want to see the word orphan kind of disappear. We want to create an environment where kids have a family.
It is the first of its kind camp for foster kids in Louisiana.
A program designed to give these children a place away from the inconsistencies of regular life and feel a little like well, royalty. WDSU anchor Randy Russo introduces us to the momentum behind Royal Family Kids Camp and how they also hope to change the foster care movement in Louisiana.
1 week can't just make a difference. One moment could change a way a child perceives who they are and the value that they have. And that's why we do what we do.
John Wonder, Jim, and his wife have been foster parents for more than 10 years now, taking in more than 12 kids and making 4 permanent fixtures of their family.
The value to me of being a foster parent is saying, I can give that to a child. I can give them that belief that they are something more. And that they're worth my time, that they're valuable.
However, John says so many foster kids go day in and day out without feeling valuable or wanted, which is why he's launching a first-of-its-kind kids camp in Louisiana exclusively for foster children, Royal Family Kids Camp.
So to be able to provide this camp where for 1 week they're just kids, they're not foster children, they're not going from one home to another home or anything like that, they're just kids who get to experience what every kid should experience.
These kinds of camps have popped up around the country over the past 3 decades. Since 1985, Royal Family Kids has helped more than 80,000 children across 35 states and in 11 countries. Now that Louisiana is getting in on the action, Sylvia Gray with the Department of Children and Family Services says it'll give foster children an outlet that they desperately need.
It's somewhere where our kids can go, and just for a little while, they can be free. They can just play. They don't have to be the mama of their little sister or the mama of their little brother. Those children can be free to just be kids.
The idea behind this camp is royalty from the very beginning. So these campers will arrive at camp on charter buses, being welcomed by counselors holding up signs with their names on them. And during camp, the girls get a special princess tea party complete with makeover and dresses. And the boys will take part in an adventure night. But John's favorite event is the all-camper birthday bash, because many of the kids he's met over the years have never had their life celebrated.
And if in this week of camp we can provide kids with some kind of hope that my life is more valuable than what people have told me it is so far, if we can give them a hope that life is worth more than what I've seen so far, then we've accomplished what we're trying to do here with camp.
Once he gets this camp off the ground, John says he hopes to expand it to other parishes across southeast Louisiana and counties in Mississippi. On your side, I'm Randy Russo, WDSU News.
Right now, about 350 kids in Louisiana foster care are waiting to be adopted. And this Saturday, the Louisiana Department of Children and Family Services is hosting an adoption day from 10 a.m. until 2 p.m. at Estrama Baptist Church. That's in Baton Rouge. For more information about Royal Family Kids Camp and the adoption event, go to our website, WDSU.com.
All right, take a live look outside now as we turn to weather and just soak it up. Enjoy the beauty. Here's Chief Meteorologist Margaret Orr on another perfect day. Margaret?
Oh, I tell you, Scott, it is beautiful. It's looking like it's going to be really nice again tomorrow. Then our rain chances begin to go up, but the truth is we could use the showers at this point. Here is a look at our satellite high pressure to the east, a southerly flow. I mean, it is dry out there, which is why it feels so great right now. Not a raindrop out there. Now, there is this big upper-level low out west, and over time, it's going to move to the east. And you can see the flow around this system to the south. That means moisture is going to be moving to the north. So as we look at your Thursday, there is a slight risk for severe storms to our west. If you have to travel, keep that in mind. We're looking fine on Thursday, maybe a 20 to 30% chance of rain. Now, hurricane season begins in the East Pacific on May 15th, and you know what? We're watching the system. Hurricane Center says about a 50% chance for tropical development. We've got this broad low over very warm water, and at this point, no real wind shear that it's dealing with, so there is some potential it could develop. And then that same upper level low is going to kind of pull some of this moisture northward and bring it into southwest Mexico. Now, when we look at an invest, generally the models are no good because there's no closed low-level circulation, and that's what our hurricane models are based on. But I do see this system moving to the northeast into that west central coast of Mexico, and over time, we could actually have a little bit of moisture moving our way going into your Friday and Saturday. Now, this is so cool. It's in Lacombe. Julie Baudier sent this in. Do you see this? That's a little wood duck that is going to the ground. The mom is down there with all the brothers and sisters. So I just had to show you. I thought that was so cute. High temperatures so far today, 82. The average is 83. The record, 92. I'm not ready for the 90s, but they're on the way. And our record low for today is 49. So it's still possible to have this cool weather. High temperatures so far, low to the mid 80s. We were a couple of degrees cooler in a few locations today. 81 Slidell at the lakefront, Belle Chasse, Chalmette, 82 at the airport, Galley. You get the picture. We're all pretty much in the low to the mid 80s now. 6 o'clock near to the low 80s, 9 o'clock upper 60s to low 70s. As we go into the morning, low temperatures North Shore, mostly low 60s. For the Mississippi Gulf Coast, mid 60s, mid to upper 60s on the South Shore. A little bit of patchy fog is possible, but the winds may be too strong for that to really get going. And then your high temperatures tomorrow in the low 80s. Here's that forecast model. Isolated shower possible tomorrow, not likely. Here we are, we're looking at your Thursday, and it's about a 20 to 30% chance. My concern is Friday. That's when we're going to have that potential for rain and storms. So as we look at your exact cast, 3 in the afternoon, you're about 81, 82 degrees. Then as you go into the week, look at this. For your Thursday, 83, Friday, 83, but you've got that 60% chance of rain and storms. Saturday, it's a 50%. For Mother's Day, a few showers possible.
All right, Margaret. Breaking news to pass along right now at 5 o'clock. This is a live look at Washington, D.C. All is clear right now at the White House after a lockdown situation. This happened after a vehicle followed a motorcade into a secure area of the White House grounds.
The Secret Service says officers stopped the vehicle near a security checkpoint at 17th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue. A driver was taken into custody, but it turns out just moments ago, the Secret Service said the man who drove into that restricted area was a Treasury Department employee. Once again, all is clear now at the White House. Still ahead, moment of silence, how the nation's lawmakers joined in solidarity, praying for the safe return of the kidnapped Nigerian girls.
And he may have to change his nickname from Money to Bug Money. How much boxer Floyd Mayweather is expected to cash in from this past weekend's big boxing match? That's big money, rather.
Coming up tonight, the drama continues surrounding the abducted schoolgirls in Kenya. And tonight, the United States has a team on the way. That and more when we see you here tonight.
On your side in Southeast Louisiana, this is WDSU News at 5 with Scott Walker, Camille Whitworth, and Chief Meteorologist Margaret Orr.
We want to see the word orphan kind of disappear. We want to create an environment where kids have a family.
It is the first of its kind camp for foster kids in Louisiana.
A program designed to give these children a place away from the inconsistencies of regular life and feel a little like, well, royalty. WDSU anchor Randy Russo introduces us to the momentum behind Royal Family Kids Camp and how they also hope to change the foster care movement in Louisiana.
1 week can't just make a difference. One moment could change a way a child perceives who they are and the value that they have, and that's why we do what we do.
John Wonder, Jim, and his wife have been foster parents for more than 10 years now, taking in more than 12 kids and making 4 permanent fixtures of their family.
The value to me of being a foster parent is saying, I can give that to a child. I can give them that belief that they are something more. And that they're worth my time, that they're valuable.
However, John says so many foster kids go day in and day out without feeling valuable or wanted, which is why he's launching a first of its kind kids camp in Louisiana exclusively for foster children, Royal Family Kids Camp.
So to be able to provide this camp where for 1 week they're just kids, they're not foster children, they're not going from one home to another home or anything like that, they're just kids who get to experience what every kid should experience.
These kinds of camps have popped up around the country over the past 3 decades. Since 1985, Royal Family Kids has helped more than 80,000 children across 35 states and in 11 countries. Now that Louisiana is getting in on the action, Sylvia Gray with the Department of Children and Family Services says it'll give foster children an outlet that they desperately need.
It's somewhere where our kids can go, and just for a little while, they can be free. They can just play. They don't have to be the mama of their little sister or the mama of their little brother, they can, those children can be free to just be kids.
The idea behind this camp is royalty from the very beginning. So these campers will arrive at camp on charter buses, being welcomed by counselors holding up signs with their names on them. And during camp, the girls get a special princess tea party complete with makeover and dresses. And the boys will take part in an adventure night. But John's favorite event is the all-camper birthday bash, because many of the kids he's met over the years have never had their life celebrated.
And if in this week of camp we can provide kids with some kind of hope that my life is more valuable than what people have told me it is so far, if we can give them a hope that life is worth more than what I've seen so far, then we've accomplished what we're trying to do here with camp.
Once he gets this camp off the ground, John says he hopes to expand it to other parishes across southeast Louisiana and counties in Mississippi. On your side, I'm Randy Russo, WDSU News.
Right now, about 350 kids in Louisiana foster care are waiting to be adopted. And this Saturday, the Louisiana Department of Children and Family Services is hosting an adoption day from 10 a.m. until 2 p.m. at Estrama Baptist Church. That's in Baton Rouge. For more information about Royal Family Kids Camp and the adoption event, go to our website, WDSU.com.
All right, take a live look outside now as we turn to weather and just soak it up. Enjoy the beauty. Here's Chief Meteorologist Margaret Orr on another perfect day. Margaret?
Oh, I tell you, Scott, it is beautiful. It's looking like it's going to be really nice again tomorrow. Then our rain chances begin to go up, but the truth is we could use the showers at this point. Here is a look at our satellite. High pressure to the east, a southerly flow. I mean, it is dry out there, which is why it feels so great right now. Not a raindrop out there. Now, there is this big upper level low out west, and over time it's going to move to the east. And you can see the flow around this system to the south. That means moisture is going to be moving to the north. So as we look at your Thursday, there is a slight risk for severe storms to our west. If you have to travel, keep that in mind. We're looking fine on Thursday, maybe a 20 to 30% chance of rain. Now, hurricane season begins in the East Pacific on May 15th. And you know what? We're watching the system. Hurricane Center says about a 50% chance for tropical development. We've got this broad low over very warm water. And at this point, no real wind shear that it's dealing with. So there is some potential it could develop. And then that same upper level low is going to kind of pull some of this moisture northward and bring it into southwest Mexico. Now, when we look at an invest, generally the models are no good because there's no closed low-level circulation, and that's what our hurricane models are based on. But I do see this system moving to the northeast into that west central coast of Mexico, and over time we could actually have a little bit of moisture moving our way going into your Friday and Saturday. Now, this is so cool. It's in Lacombe. Julie Baudier sent this in. Do you see this? That's a little wood duck that is going to the ground. The mom is down there with all the brothers and sisters. So I just had to show you. I thought that was so cute. High temperatures so far today, 82. The average is 83. The record, 92. I'm not ready for the 90s, but they're on the way. And our record low for today is 49. So it's still possible to have this cool weather. High temperatures so far, low to the mid 80s. We were a couple of degrees cooler in a few locations today. 81 Slidell at the lakefront, Belle Chasse, Chalmette, 82 at the airport, Galley. You get the picture. We're all pretty much in the low to the mid 80s now. 6 o'clock near to the low 80s, 9 o'clock upper 60s to low 70s. As we go into the morning, low temperatures North Shore, mostly low 60s. For the Mississippi Gulf Coast, mid 60s, mid to upper 60s on the South Shore. A little bit of patchy fog is possible, but the winds may be too strong for that to really get going. And then your high temperatures tomorrow in the low 80s. Here's that forecast model. Isolated shower possible tomorrow, not likely. Here we are, we're looking at your Thursday, and it's about a 20 to 30% chance. My concern is Friday. That's when we're going to have that potential for rain and storms. So as we look at your exact cast, 3 in the afternoon, you're about 81, 82 degrees. Then as you go into the week, look at this. For your Thursday, 83, Friday, 83, but you've got that 60% chance of rain and storms. Saturday, it's a 50% for Mother's Day. A few showers possible.
All right, Margaret. Breaking news to pass along right now at 5 o'clock. This is a live look at Washington, D.C. All is clear right now at the White House after a lockdown situation. This happened after a vehicle followed a motorcade into a secure area of the White House grounds.
The Secret Service says officers stopped the vehicle near a security checkpoint at 17th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue. A driver was taken into custody, but it turns out just moments ago, the Secret Service said the man who drove into that restricted area was a Treasury Department employee. Once again, all is clear now at the White House. Still ahead, moment of silence. How the nation's lawmakers joined in solidarity, praying for the safe return of the kidnapped Nigerian girls.
And he may have to change his nickname from Money to Bug Money. How much boxer Floyd Mayweather is expected to cash in from this past weekend's big boxing match? That's big money, rather.
Coming up tonight, the drama continues surrounding the abducted schoolgirls in Kenya. And tonight, the United States has a team on the way. That and more when we see you here tonight.
Members of Congress and staff members held a moment of silence outside the U.S. Capitol today for hundreds of kidnapped girls in Nigeria.
The event was organized by the Congressional African Staff Association. That begins our look at news across America tonight. Nearly 300 girls were abducted from a boarding school on April 14th, and at least eight more have been kidnapped from a village. The Islamist militant group Boko Haram has admitted to taking the girls, ages 12 to 15. A man claiming to be the group's leader appeared in a video Monday announcing he would sell his victims. The U.S. is sending help to Nigeria, including intelligence and negotiation experts, to aid in the search.
The White House is issuing a new report that sounds the climate change alarm for future generations. The National Climate Assessment warns of warmer temperatures, rising sea levels, and more erratic weather. Its authors say the weather extremes we've seen this year and last are evidence this country must take action before it's too late. Some Republican lawmakers question whether humans are actually behind the dramatic changes in the climate.
When Floyd Mayweather fought and beat Marcos Maidana in Las Vegas, he knew he'd make at least $32 million. He also knew that he would make more than that off the pay-per-view contract. But nobody knew exactly how much. Well, now it looks like Mayweather could possibly pick up an additional $38 million on the back end of that deal. That would put his take from that fight at about $70 million. The $32 million breaks down to $14,815 per second, $888,000 per minute, more than $2.6 million per round, or $32 million in 36 minutes. Not shabby.
That's big cash right there. All new at 6.
It's been an eyesore in the community for years, but things might be about to change at this Algiers apartment complex. Sean Blake Hansen with what one nonprofit is trying to do to fix things up.
Tomorrow at 5, in a city known for great restaurants, a new trend is popping up when some of your favorites close for the night. We'll show you why some popular chefs are passing the plate to their employees to promote the next generation. That is tomorrow at 5.
All right, that's all the time we have, and we will see you right back here at 6 o'clock. Have a good one, everybody.